time to be holy. Speak off with thy Lord. Abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends of God's children. Help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to see. Take time to be holy. The world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let him be thy guide, and run not before him, whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow. Still follow thy Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy. Be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each temper beneath his control. Thus, led by his Spirit to fountains of love, thou shalt soon be fitted for service above.
Jesus' name we pray. Almighty Father, we are grateful unto you this morning. Lord, we are requesting that you will cause to down upon us the knowledge essential, or this knowledge essential for our living. We are praying that you will provide answers to those that are doubtful, have doubting minds. And you will give clear understanding to your children, so they may know what you expect of them naturally. And may this knowledge of truth go far, reaching to mankind everywhere. Especially the church of God, that they might receive the blessing you have given to us in nature, which is to glorify your name. Thank you, Father. We are talking on Christianity and medicine. Father, thank you for giving us medicine, as you have given us other things in life, to advance our lives and our work, even our ministries. The Lord be honored. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. We are considering Christianity and medicine. Christianity and medicine. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 22 and 21 to 23. Therefore let no man glory in men, for all things are yours. All things are yours. Whether Paul or Apollos, or Cephas, or the world, or life, or dead, or things present, or things to come, all are yours, and ye are Christ's, and Christ is God's. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, First Timothy chapter 6 verse 17. Charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded or trusting on certain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. All things to enjoy. My emphasis is on all things. All things are yours. Things that are beneficial to you in the creation of God, they are yours. God has given us all things richly to enjoy. That which will give you peace, that which will give you joy, that which will give you rest, is given to you by God. All things God has given to you to enjoy. I'm talking about in the moral sense of it. Not in evil, but that which ministers unto you. Before the introduction of conventional medicine, medicine had existed in the world. People had been taking medication and getting healed to the point that the Bible, the scripture says, God's word doeth good like medicine. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 17, verse 22. Proverbs 17, verse 22. The Bible says, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. This tells us medicines do good. Is that okay? Yes. And the scripture has said medicine, that's what? Medicines do good. Medicines do good to mankind. And in the book of Isaiah, the Bible speaks there in chapter 5. Isaiah. The Bible speaks there telling us that in verse 20, chapter 5, verse 20, it says, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. The scripture has told us that medicine is a good thing. Just as the Bible says, my son, eat thou honey, for honey is good. If the Bible calls honey as a good thing, and somebody comes to forbid the eating of honey and said, don't eat honey, the Bible says, woe unto that man. Why did you say the people should not eat honey? It is evil. That which God has called good, are you now the one coming to say it is evil? No. In First Timothy chapter 4, the Bible tells us, First Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the later times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And in verse 3, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats which God had created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. The devil interferes a lot in among mankind to turn them off from that which is good by naming it evil, especially in the church. To the point that some creation of God, beautiful as it is, given for human benefits, Satan will come and say it is bad. Or he passes through some preachers, some religious men, to lay a bad name on such a thing. Yes, medicine has suffered that. Many people have come up to say it is a sin to take medicine. That, in fact, those that take medicine will go to hell. It shows they don't have faith on Jesus Christ. That is a doctrine of the devil. Doctrine. The scripture says medicine is good. And the Bible says God created all things. He has made them good. He has made, he said in verse 3, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meat, which God had created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. Verse 4, for every creature of God is what? Is good. He created it for to be received by believers, them that believe and know the truth. Receive it with thanksgiving. Your prayer over it sanctifies it, purifies it. It becomes for your use. So you bless God. You are happy. You thank him for his wisdom. Yet there are people, in fact, I don't know, maybe up to now, there are people who don't use the handset. Because when telephone came in the handset, they said it is, this thing should be the mark of the beast. No, how will you be here and be calling somebody in a country, in a far away place, and be speaking to him unconnected? It must have something to do with Satan. They should withdraw themselves. People are always by the devil misinterpreting the good works of God. Knowledge is good. That's what the Bible says. It is not good that a man be without knowledge. And God said, the Bible says, in the later times, knowledge shall increase. That's Bible. And he said, the knowledge is good. Knowledge of discoveries is a good thing. Otherwise, there won't be advancement in human society. So, let's go to scripture, know the scripture, the language of scripture, the spirit of scripture, to enjoy the fullness of God in this life. Yes. Medicine exists purely separate from Satanism. Although Satan often takes advantage of this to introduce his vices to humanity and lead them to bondage. Satan takes over. See it. Water. Who created water?
God.
Is it for good?
Yes.
For good. You can go to water and take bath. You can go to the river, go to the stream, take bath or whatever, as humanity do. It's not that it's recommended for bathing. Some people use it. And they use it in various ways. Some can just sit by it and enjoy nature. Or go and watch it. But Satan has made human beings to fear a body of water. Because they say, mommy water spirit. Please leave that place, leave that place. Mommy water spirits are there. Leave that place, leave that place. Don't enter into that water. You don't know what is inside. Satan is inside. Satan has laid claim on the body of water by showing human being that his kingdom is inside water. Who gave him that power? God created water for man, not Satan. With this knowledge, you can go to any body of water and do that which is natural, which will minister to your good, minister to the good of mankind. You're not sinning. So in the same way, the people have people are thinking that, all this medicine, all these drugs, all these herbs, all these leaves that are mixing, it is Satan. What makes it Satan? Satan created them?
No.
They are the handiwork of God. And God has made them good. It's Satan that is taking advantage of this thing to promote his name. So, we should take note of that. We are still going to tell you more as we go forward. Now, God leads man instinctively and by other means to discover that which is good for his life. That's something you can know. I've told you, medicine has been a practice long in the world. God directs man how to discover the things he has put in his world to use them for the good of man and for his glory. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 28, verse 26, Isaiah 28, verse 26, the scripture tells us here saying, "For his God doth instruct him to discretion and doth teach him." You may be wondering, how did man come up with the knowledge of this? The aeroplanes, the ship, the aeroplane in the air, the ship on the sea, and the vehicles on the road. How did man come to invent this? Let's read the answer, verse 26. 1, 2, go. "For his God doth instruct him to discretion and doth teach him." You might also be asking, how did man discover medicine? And some of these traditional medicine people, how did they know that taking this leaf with that leaf with that leaf will cure a sickness? Let's reach the answer again. Verse 26. 1, 2, go. "For his God doth instruct him to discretion and doth teach him." You may also ask, how did the doctor come to operate a man and discover something, gives that thing a name? How do they come to know the functions of the various parts of the human body? They can draw it up and label it. And how did he come to know this? How do they come? Let's come back to the answer. Verse 26. 1, 2, go. "For his God doth instruct him to discretion and doth teach him." But how? Come, but in the village, there is somebody there that is able to know how to do this, how to cure this, how to cure that, how to cure this. What, how did it happen to? How did it happen? Let's go back to the answer. One, two, go. For his God doth instruct him to discretion and doth teach him. God, who made this lie, knows the needs of the lie and teaches people, instructs people, tells them. Sometimes it may happen in a dream. In a dream, they just see somebody perform this. Sometimes it may be a voice that may speak to them. A voice that may speak. Sometimes it is just instinct. The mind is able to imagine some things and just see the reality of those things. As I'm going to walk it out and see. And it works. Why do we think that God created this world and it is Satan that is managing it for God? That everything that is happening is Satan. Hey, be careful, Satan. Why are you thinking like that? Now, take it. The animals, sheep, goats, cows, dogs, chicken, that hen and others, and the bush ones too, do they get sick?
Yes.
Do they get sick?
Yes.
Who cures them? How are they cured?
They go to look for the leaves that will cure them.
They go to look for?
God directs them.
Can you see it now? Even the animal, how do they treat their sickness? Let's go back to that scripture. But instead of say he's God now, it's God. Is that clear?
Yes.
One, two, go. For it's God doth instruct it to discretion and doth teach it. Can you see God? Now, do you see God in everything now?
Yes.
Do you see God in the knowledge of life? Beneficial knowledge of life. Do you see him? Do you know that Satan hates everything that is good?
Yes.
He is never for the benefit of mankind. Anything that is good, except he will use it as he will quote from scripture. I want to achieve an evil purpose, but it must still be scripture must come in. He will use a good thing which is from God and want to put his evil inside. But for good, good doesn't come from Satan. Therefore, please don't ever always allot everything, every good thing that goes on in this life to Satan. Even among unbelievers, the God that made them wants them to be healthy. If they die, how will they hear the gospel? How will they hear the message? That doesn't the Bible say it's not the will of God that any man should die, but that all should come to repentance? Will not God therefore do all required to keep them alive until they can have opportunity to come to repentance? So where do you think that the people among them who are treating them in their sicknesses and diseases are all demonic? Silver demonism from medicine is different. They are two different things. They are two different things. Demonism and medicine. A man is first demonic. Then he gets good medicine. And his demonism may affect it or may not affect it. Because good medicine is a natural formula. Then he can only bring his demonism into it by saying, okay, before I do this for you, sacrifice this. You must do this. When you are cooking this medicine, don't transfer the firewood. Don't take firewood from one side to another. That's demonism. All those things are not the real thing. They are to bring man into bondage to Satan. You get it now? Demonism and medicine are two separate things. Be it natural medicine or conventional medicine, be it all this food supplement medicine or anything, separate the two. Don't go on those who feel that, hey, this thing is demonic. Hey, the Holy Ghost has revealed. Be careful. The revelation is in Scripture. Revelation is in Scripture. Except if any specific evil is done, just like anybody can do good, do a bad thing to food, can poison food, but the food naturally is a good thing. Is that okay?
Yes.
So, demonism is different from medicine. What therefore you are to avoid, run away from, is demonism. What defiles a Christian, a believer, is demonism, not medicine. Whether herbal, conventional, traditional, or whatever thing. It is that aspect of the treatment that is in darkness, that has no the light of Scripture, that Satan takes over, for he is the prince of darkness. Amen?
Amen.
The people who do the inventions for us in various things of life are not all believers. Why are we not saying the aeroplane is demonic? Why are we not saying the vehicle is also demonic? Why are we not saying the clothes manufactured for us are demonic? The people who made them are unbelievers. Are we now saying unbelievers who do treatment are demonic? Or their treatment is demonic because they are unbelievers? Look well and understand that Scripture. Now, we want to consider cases of sickness of the righteous. Because there are people who think the righteous cannot be sick. And that is another gospel in excess. It's another gospel in excess. Not that the righteous must be sick. No. No. Of course, the inhabitants shall not say, I am sick. God can manifest his power to that point on a special sense. As he led the children of Israel from Egypt to the promised land, and the Bible said there was no feeble man among them. Even the cloth that they put in their body did not wear away. That is special manifestation of God. God can make that choice. But is it everybody, is it that believers' clothes don't wear away? Eh? They wear away. Your clothes have worn away many times. The clothes you were using before, in fact, 3-4 years ago, you are not using them again. Why? They have followed the law of nature. At times, God will allow the law of nature to take effect. Why? He has made sufficient provision to counteract it. He has made sufficient provision to counteract it. So be free. Do you know that the brook of water that Elijah was sent to by God followed the law of nature and that it dried up eventually? To the point that he had to look for another place because that was the law of nature. And God allowed nature to have its own course. He did not choose to alter it. He can alter it. He can alter it by miracle, but he didn't do it. He didn't do it. He didn't do it. Ezra was saying, I would have gone to the king to say, King, give us escort to move to Jerusalem because of thieves on the way, because of evil men, attackers on the way. That is a natural thing. But something, and it wouldn't have been seen. Will it have been seen?
No.
It wouldn't have been seen. You know, people who don't understand scriptures go their own way. And they'll be doing things that you think is scripture. Where is that man of God carrying security men? Why are you asking that? Is it evil? Most people who see Jesus said they see him with two angels. They see him with an angel. They see him with this. Jesus. It's a law. It's not that anybody would do him anything. But they are essential to render service. That a preacher goes with some people, wisdom, you don't know wisdom. Ezra now said, but because I have told the king about the greatness of God, within this short period, if I go back again, no, my message will be mixed up. God, we would have required security normally, as is expected in a journey like this. But I want you to consider something. We're hooked up. I want you to consider something. I have told the king about you. That you can do this, you can do this, you can do that. Oh Lord, give us your security. It worked for him. There was a special need for it. Otherwise, the normal law of life in such a journey takes security. For ye shall not tempt the Lord your God. When Jesus noticed that they wanted to kill him in the Jewry, he never walked among the Jewry. So, let's have complete understanding. Therefore, can the righteous be sick? Yes. The righteous man can be sick and can be oppressed by the devil. He is in this world. Satan is in this world. In the book of Psalm 41, verse 1 to verse 3. Psalm 41, verse 1 to verse 3. Blessed is he that considereth the poor. The Lord will deliver him in time of trouble. The Lord will preserve him and keep him alive. And he shall be blessed upon the earth. And thou wilt not deliver him unto the will of his enemies. Now, can we read verse 3 together? The Lord will strengthen him upon the bed of languishing. Thou wilt make all his bed in his sickness. Who is this man the Lord is talking about? Can he be sick?
Yes.
The righteous can be sick. The righteous can be sick. Therefore, know this scripture so that humility will always be with you. Know this scripture so that you don't go into hypocrisy and be giving false testimonies to show how righteous you are and be attaching it to righteousness. No, I have not been sick all this while. In fact, since I gave my life to Jesus, know the scripture. It's grace you have enjoyed. Praise God. And there's natural grace. Even sinners, there are those who have never been sick. But as for reality, the righteous can be sick. Is that God will heal him.
Yes.
Are you getting it now? Thou will make all thy beds in thy sickness. In the book of Job, I read chapter 2, verse 7 and verse 8. Job chapter 2, verse 7 and verse 8. So when Satan fought from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot unto his crown, and he took him a potsherd to scrape himself withal, and he sat down among the ashes. Can you see? Satan went out from the presence of who?
The Lord.
The Lord was aware that Job would be sick. The Lord knew today that in the evening Job would catch a sickness. He knew today that tomorrow Job will catch a sickness. He knew. What did God do about it? What did God do? He knew. What did God do about it? He was quiet. I want you to know this, so that you should be a humble and meek child of God. Isaac was bound. Isaac didn't shake and give Abraham all the chance to bound him, to bind him. He didn't shake. So please, some miseries will come. Don't deal roughly with God. Don't deal roughly with God. Some sickness may come on your way. God, did you not know? Were you not aware that it was coming? Did he not know? He knew. Was he not aware? He was. That it will happen in the way it has happened? That the name of the sickness will be called this? Was he aware?
Yes.
He was aware. But he kept quiet. Because you don't know the contention between him and Satan. You don't know what he is planning to do concerning the situation. Were you not created for his glory? What if he decides to kill you? You say it's bad? Job said, though he slays me, I will trust in him. So be calm. Don't find fault with God. Don't find fault with God. Even to the length of the sickness. Come, did Job pray the first day he saw the sign? The period he prayed, that period of sickness, was Job praying for himself? That God should heal him? Was God answering the prayers? That's what Job said. If I could see God with my eyes, I will ask him, what's your reason? Can somebody take God to court? I mean, Job was reasoning. Oh, that when a man can take God to court, we will stand before God. But who will be the advocate? So you have prayed, wait for him. He told you, he's aware. You are praying, but wait for him. He is achieving something in a set time. Wait for him. The vision is yet for an appointed time. Though it tarry, what do you do? Wait for it. At the end, the Lord will appear for you. Give a clap offering to Jesus. Amen. So Job was oppressed. Who did it? Who did it to Job?
Satan.
So can Satan oppress a child of God? Yes. Then where are you always saying to the child of God, oppressed in his dream, that he belongs to secret society, that it is initiation? Why do you say so? No child of God must dream like that. No child. You are destroying the faith. You are confusing a man. Who told you that no child of God can dream like that? Is that a satanic oppression? Rather pray. Satan has come on your way. Check him up. Come. What are the signs that a person is a child of God? Is it that he will not be dreaming bad dreams?
No.
Is it part of the signs?
No.
For whoever is born of God does not commit sin. Is he involved in his dream? Did he invite the spirit of the dream?
No.
Was he aware of the dream?
No.
Was his will involved in the dream?
No.
Then where are you saying he has committed sin? He dreamed that he swam in the water. He says, mommy spirit. You need to go for deliverance. He dreamed that a woman came and he made love with a woman in a dream. Oh, you are initiated. Where did you get this your gospel from? Where is this gospel from? Can you quote the scriptures? And yet in the real sense, this man is a righteous man. This man is holy. He's just passing through satanic oppression. The two are different. The two are different. So that's what we need to understand, so that we have a balanced Christianity and not bring worries, anxieties to a child of God. Let him rather continue to pray until the matter is over. Let him seek counsel, seek prayer until the matter is over. Amen?
Amen.
My brother there, can you say amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, that is what we need to know. Now we have known that Job was sick. You know, there are preachers that say many things. Job was righteous and was yet afflicted with sickness. Not for his sins, but for a cause that laid in the hands of God. Yes, the Bible tells us in James chapter 5, the prayer of faith shall save the sick. And if he has committed any sin, it shall be forgiven him. But remember the word if. It's not that his sickness must have come because of sin. No. If. Because he could also be sick without being a sinner or without having backsliding. It's not necessarily divine judgment. It's attack of the devil. Or law of nature. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Because there might be some particular sickness common in your father's lineage. It may be common. It can pass to you. Can it? Can pass to you. Can pass to you. Ah, my blood is the blood of Jesus Christ. No sin can. Pray. No sickness can pass to me. Pray and use faith to resist it. Otherwise, it's a natural flow. It's a law. It's only you have hope. If it comes, there's a healer. You have a healer. The difference between you and the rest of the family members is you know where you can be healed. How you can be healed by faith in Christ. They don't know because they don't believe in Jesus. That's the difference. Or else you know also how to exercise faith and stop that. Since you have already known the thing, pray I will hear you. That's your difference. And that means you have to actively do something about it. Now, Elisha was sick. In the book of 2 Kings, chapter 13, verse 14. 2 Kings, chapter 13, verse 14. The Bible says, now, Elisha was falling sick of his sickness whereof he died. Everybody, can you read to that point? One, two, go. Now, Elisha was falling sick of his sickness whereof he died. You know Elisha? Who was he? A man of double portion anointing. Yes, the presence of God is in him. The dead shall rise. Elisha. The river Jordan divided. Elisha. The Shunammite woman, a child. The Shunammite woman's child came back to life. Elisha. He fell sick. Was he backsliding at this time?
No.
Let me show you the sign that he was not backsliding. In verse In that same scripture, verse 14, now Elisha was falling sick of his sickness, whereof he died. And Joash, the king of Israel, came down unto him and wept over his face and said, oh, my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And Elisha said unto him, take bow and arrows. And he took unto him bow and arrows. And he said to the king of Israel, put thy hand upon the bow. And he put his hand upon it. And Elisha said, shh. As Elisha put his hands upon the king's hands. And he said, open the window eastward. And he opened it eastward. Then Elisha said, shoot. And he shot. And he said, the arrow of the Lord's deliverance. And the arrow of deliverance from Syria. For thou shalt smite the Syrians in Aphek till thou have consumed them. Prophecy continued. Prophecy continued. Can you see? And yet he was still. I'm saying this because, you know, we who are men of God, pride can come in. Pride. Satanic ways are technical. Hey, if you allow your member to know that you are sick, your ministry has finished. Who told you? A child of God can be sick. A child of God can be sick. You know, there's a men of God. The Lord gave a privilege to someone which another person may not have that privilege. He has reasons why he allowed many things. Because he wants to teach knowledge. He wants to teach understanding to his people. Jacob finished blessing his children and brought his legs back to the bed and slept and died peacefully. Men of faith, I don't need to be sick. In my dying, I will not be sick. I'll just sit down like that and the Lord will take me. There are preachers from the Lord who there was, you didn't hear that they were sick. They didn't die in sickness. They sat down like that and talking to other people and fell down and died, but they're not in heaven. Is that true? Praise the Lord. Exactly. What happened to such one is Satan, not God. So why are you glorying over that? Why are you teaching that as doctrine? That somebody fell sick, you say, no, a believer cannot die, cannot be sick and say you die in sickness. No. What are you saying? What are you saying? Instead of encouraging him, while a person is very sick, have two minds. One, you will recover. Two, in case you do not recover, prepare for heaven. For the Hebrew children inside, who the Nebuchadnezzar threatened them to throw them to fire. They said, our God is able to deliver us. If he does not, we are still ready to die for him and never bow. Because God may choose not to deliver. Amen?
Amen.
Always mind eternity. Elisha died in sickness. Let not Satan pump pride to you in your dying sickness, so that instead of humility, you become, no, I'm coming out, go and wait for me. It's like some of these people who say they are Jesus. They say they are waking up on the third day. They should bury them now. Tomorrow they are coming. After 3 days, they should wait for them. And the people waited for 3 days. They didn't see them coming out of the grave. They say, oh, let's add another one day. And they perish, man, because of pride. So don't allow that. Ever be humble. And don't induce pride also into your brother. rather caught the promises of God to strengthen his faith. But study the circumstance and also remember the other hand. God made the right hand, he made the left. The right leg, the left leg. The right eye, the left eye. So there are these two chances in sickness, to live or to die. Remember, in case the thing is going somehow, to prepare the person for eternity. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, we are moving forward. We have now known that the righteous can be sick. Epaphras was sick. Epaphras was sick. It's Philippians chapter 2, verse 25 to 28. Philippians chapter 2, verse 25 to 28. The Bible says, yet I suppose it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, and companion in labor, and fellow soldier, but your messenger, and he that ministered to my wants. Verse 26. For he longed after you all, and was full of heaviness. Can we read the remaining line? Because that ye had heard that he had been sick. For indeed he was sick near unto death. But God had mercy on him. And not on him only, but also on me. Lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Learn something here. Under the ministry of Apostle Paul, Epaphras was sick. The sickness lived long to the point that they feared he would die. Paul, what about giving Epaphras a handkerchief? Paul, you didn't have apron. What about laying apron upon Epaphras? Thus manifested in a brief moment in my ministry. There were not things that continued with me. Okay, all right. Then Paul, were you not the one the Lord has been using you for miracles? Roundabout? This one now is with you. What happened that he was not yet healed? Why? Paul, it's you. Doesn't God hear you? He hears me. But he said, this thing you are talking about is not a matter of boasting. I will go and set him free. Ah, is God that had mercy on me? It took me long prayers, not only me and others. We were praying. God showed us mercy. So don't think almighty healing is in my hand. That every case, bring it, I will handle it. Not even in Jesus. When he went home to his home, he laid hands on a few people. Why? The unbelief was with them. Unbelief was with them. Not even in Jesus. His Epaphras may not be the case of unbelief. It may just be that the Lord is teaching a lesson. Paul, you and those who are walking with you, learn to have rest. You didn't know when I withdrew my disciples for a rest? You didn't know? I will remind you now. Praise the Lord. And so the man was sick. All prayers didn't work. But the mercy of God. God had mercy on him. Which means you may not. Hezekiah presented his righteousness. God had him. But it's not all the time that he will heal you because of your righteousness. It's mercy. It's mercy. God showed him mercy. God showed me mercy. And God healed him. Amen?
Amen.
That's what the word of God is saying. Now, let's go on again, number two. Promises of protection, healing, and deliverance. God's promises for protection, healing, and deliverance. In the book of Exodus chapter 15. Exodus chapter 15. We read verse 26. And said, if thou wilt diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give him, and I will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon thee, which I have brought upon the Egyptians. For I am the Lord that healeth thee. God afflicts sinners with diseases, but not his faithful children. He afflicts sinners because he said, I will put them on your enemy, not on you. As part of judgment, because he's the God of judgment. For sinners, for the children of God, God is their healer. When sickness comes upon them, God goes to heal them. He is their healer. You don't call somebody a doctor when there's no cure, nothing to cure anybody about. Amen? You don't call somebody a doctor when there's nothing he's doing in curing people, except if he's an academic doctor. Amen. Amen. In the book of Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 14 and 15. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 14 and 15. The Bible tells us here saying, thou shalt be blessed above all people. There shall not be male or female barren among you or among your cattle. And the Lord will take away from thee all sickness, and will put none of the evil diseases of Egypt, which thou knowest, upon thee, but will lay them upon all them that hate thee. That's his promise. He will lay them upon thee. There shall be none barren among you. Understand it scripturally. Zachariah and Elizabeth, his wife, stayed with that children for long. Why? She was barren. But how long? God was watching it. Did it come to an end? Yes. It came to an end. So, it may not talk about a momentary position. It may both refer to a momentary position and the final case of thing. The Lord will take care. The Lord will take care. That's God's promise. But if you also examine scriptures, you will still have other things to learn on this matter. Understanding will keep you. Discretion will preserve you. Are you hearing me? Paul didn't marry. Who made him not to marry? God, definitely. Who gives wives to men? Did not give him one. It will affect the work he was called to do. Amen. Similarly, somebody else may marry a child of God, a minister of the gospel, and the Lord will not give them children. Why? It may affect the work they are called to do. Is that so? Some of these people may not marry, both men and women. They are genuine ones. It's only there are people who force themselves into it. No grace for them. The genuine ones have grace. God called them. God made it so. They have grace. So, now, let's go further. Let's go further. In 3 John verse 2, we're talking about promises. Of God's promises for protection, healing, and deliverance. 3 John, verse 2. There, the Bible tells us, saying, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospered." That's the wish of God. Your prosperity and health is God's desire for you. Follow the conditions required for them. You will find them according to the will of God. Amen. I wish above all things. It's God's desire for you. Is God's desire. Have it like that, my brother. Pursue it and get it done. In the book of Matthew, chapter 15, verse 22 to 28. Matthew 15, verse 22 to 28. The Bible tells us also here, saying, "And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coasts and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with a devil. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. And he answered and said," can we read verse 26? "But he answered and said, It is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs." Which thing now is the children's bread? Healing and deliverance. It means his children can get sick. His children can be oppressed. Therefore, whenever they are sick, as anybody is hungry, you give them food. You give them healing. You give them deliverance. They are for children. Then children can be sick. Children can be oppressed by the devil. Yet, how do you know that they are children? They are not committing sin. They are not committing sin. But the person who is possessed by the devil commits sin. Because Satan has taken even the will. He does things that are evil. So we say no. Don't say a child of God has been possessed by Satan. As long as you see him doing wickedness now, righteousness has gone. But a real child, man of God, can have sickness, can have Satan disturbing one way or the other. Satan can kill his child. Yes. Satan can kill his wife. Yes. But remember that God was aware. Is that so? God was aware and watched it. Maybe you didn't rise up to fight at the appropriate time. But to some, he allowed it so. There's a lesson in life that lies behind the curtain, known only to God. Sometimes Satan knows too. Amen? Okay. So, now, we understand that the righteous can be sick, oppressed, barren, and poor. But God is our Savior, provider, healer, and deliverer. How does the Lord heal and deliver? How does the Lord heal and deliver? Number one, through activating the word of his promise. God can make you, by the word of his promise, sustain you that sickness will not come. By the word of his promise, he can sustain you and sickness will not come. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou may prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. God can keep you in health. You will not know sickness. The inhabitants will not say, I am sick. This is preventive healing. The sickness does not come, which many of us enjoy. Sometimes long, prolonged. Sometimes for a period. We enjoy. In some respect, we enjoy this. The activating of his word. It shall come to pass before they call. What will happen? I will hear. The answer comes before the matter even began. They poison your food and you're not even aware. God took care. You're not even aware. So beautiful. In this sense, God is doing many things unaware to us, which we need to thank him. Again, how does he heal? Through personal faith and prayer on his word and promises. In the book of Psalm 107, verse 20. Psalm 107, verse 20. But let's start from verse 17. Fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. Their soul abhorreth all manner of meat, and they draw near unto the gates of death. Let's read verse 19 together. One, two, go. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he severed them out of their distresses. Verse 20. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Prayer and faith on God's promises. The trouble came. Maybe they committed sin. Or whichever way the sickness came, go to God in prayer. Cry to him. Call upon him. Fight in his name. Fight by his word. You will be healed. This is one way God does it. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Again, number three, through prayers and intercession of others over the sick. through prayers and intercession of others over the sick. In James chapter 5, James chapter 5, we read verse, James chapter 5, verse 14. All through to 16. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults. Now let's read verse 16 together. One, two, go. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Can you see? Intercession. Intercession. You know, where we're saying this, some people can be proud. How will I even make anybody know that I am sick? I should say, hey, bro, I have a stomach problem that is disturbing me. Ah, me who heal people. If you say like that, they won't come to you for healing again. No? We want to give you the complete knowledge of Scripture so that these darknesses of sins and iniquity should leave your life. The appropriate humility of God can come upon your life. Here, are you sick? You have been praying for that sickness. It didn't work. You prayed and prayed and prayed. The Bible said two are better than one, for they have a good reward for their labor. Get another person. Let it make the thing known. In fact, the thing has become so heavy. Call elders. And the prayers elders will pray for you will bring you healing. Now, among yourselves, learn to pray for yourself, which means confess yourself. In case you have done anything that would block the healing, confess it. Then call yourselves. Call yourselves and be praying for yourselves. You will be healed. Are you people not righteous? The prayer of the righteous availeth much. But which prayer? Effectual, fervent. Not this casual thing you are doing. Effectual prayer. Standing, prolonging, standing on it. It works. It works. That's the scripture. Therefore, it could be you. Seek prayer. Seek prayer. Call your brother. Thank God there are people who have gifts of healing among us. The Lord has been using them. Don't be ashamed to invite him. Agree with me. Invite her. Agree with me, sister. People, the Lord has been using them on deliverance. My sister, my brother, the thing that is happening in my family, Satan has come. He said, ah, but you are a coordinator. Coordinator doesn't eat food. Call. Yeah, this man is a genius to me. He's only possible. Remember, tomorrow you will come down and a genius will take over. Is that not possible? Thank you very much. So, in that way, you can be healed. God is the one that arranged this thing. So, and when the circumstance for this comes, the signal will be signaling you. Signal. Signal. Call somebody else. Call somebody else. As long as you say, God, no, I'm too big to call somebody, you are there. God loves that type of person to teach him lesson that if without humility, you are nothing before me. So let others learn that a big man like you remains sick because of shame. There's no shame for the righteous. Be humble. Then God can take you everywhere. God can do everything for you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Again, through the use of medicine, with prayers and faith, the use of medicine with prayers and faith, God heals. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 38, verse 1 to verse 8. Isaiah 38, verse 1 to verse 8, verse 21 and 22. The Bible tells us here, saying, in those days was Hezekiah sick unto death. And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, came unto him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die and not live. Then Hezekiah turned his face toward the wall and prayed unto the Lord and said, remember now, O Lord, I beseech thee, how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept so. Then came the word of the Lord to Isaiah, saying, go and say to Hezekiah, thus saith the Lord, the God of David thy father, I have heard thy prayer. I have seen thy tears. Behold, I will add unto thy days 15 years, and I will deliver thee and this city out of the hand of the king of Assyria, and I will defend this city. And this shall be a sign unto thee from the Lord, that the Lord will do this thing that he hath spoken. Behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees, which is gone down in the son Deel of Ahaz, 10 degrees backward. So the sun returned 10 degrees, by which degrees it was gone down. Then verse 21 now. For Isaiah had said, let them take a lump of fig and lay it for a plaster upon the boil, and he shall recover. That's exactly. Are you seeing the story? The man of God, righteous, was sick. And even God himself said, you will die. He didn't agree with that message. He said, God, my heart didn't agree. I still have a conviction that I need to do something on this earth. So, please, God, don't do that. God gave that chance. Maybe the Lord was saying, Hezekiah, do you feel... there are two options now. Do you feel you could die? He said, no. I want to do something more for you here. A sickness had come. Now, I want you to learn something. Hezekiah was sick. And the Lord now, through answer to prayer, had promised that I will heal you. It didn't happen instantaneously. It didn't. That's why God had to give a sign. However you see the delay of that thing, I have said it will go. Let me give you a sign. Then rest on that sign and don't bother about it again, for it shall go. The Lord did that, drew the sun backward a little. And I don't know how long it took finally for that thing to go, but there was no more. But how did it happen? The Lord told Isaiah, tell him, I say his God doth instruct him. The Lord instructed Isaiah, let them lay a plaster of fig, a lump of fig as plaster on the boil. That was done. The healing didn't take place that day. It might have been gradual. gradual, until it all got disappeared. To show you that the word that comes out of the mouth of God does not return to him void until he has fulfilled what he has spoken. But remember, a plaster of figs was involved. That was medicine. That was medicine. A plaster of figs was involved. That was medicine. Again, see another form of medicine in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 23. First Timothy chapter 5, verse 23. It reads, drink no longer water, but use a little wine for thy stomach's sake and thine often infirmities. The wine there was a medicine. It has a property to silence stomach problem. It has a property to silence stomach problem. But what about faith? Couldn't faith silence it? Couldn't the prayer of faith silence it? Timothy prayed. It didn't work. He revealed it to Paul. Sir, there's a stomach problem disturbing me. Paul prayed. It didn't disappear. Now, Paul used wisdom. Be taking little wine. Because if you drink water, water has a biting effect on your stomach. But wine has a soothing effect, a healing effect on your stomach. And God made it for our good. Not in alcoholic wine at this time, no. Because a strong drink is a deceiver. You can't drink it little. So, take it. It works. Somebody has a headache. And he said, please, let me buy paracetamol. He said, bro, don't waste my money. We will block out that headache now. We'll blot it out. We'll blot it out. Just bring down your head now. Just bring down your head. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Have you heard?
Yes, sir.
Get a balanced scripture. Your Christian life will be different. Because understanding shall keep you. Discretion shall preserve you. God also can heal by his sovereignty. The man lying in the pool of Bethesda, he didn't ask for healing. Did he ask for healing? Did anybody pray for him? Jesus just came. Will you be healed? He was thinking it is the healing of the pool. He said, I don't have anybody to carry me there. Rise up and be healed. God can see. That's why people are healing the crusade. Not for their righteousness. Not even because they have faith. Not even because they prayed. The sovereignty of God. Sinners enjoy this. The sovereignty of God. Well, now, reasons for this exposition. To comply with Christ's instruction to teach all things. We are doing this thing to comply with Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 to 20. Matthew chapter 28. Verse 18 to 20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power. power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And Paul also said in Colossians chapter 1, verse 28 and verse 29, he says, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. We're doing this because the Lord said we should teach you all things written in scripture for your knowledge. And number two, to keep believers from effect of ignorance. To keep believers from the effect of ignorance. In the book of Hosea, Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Just note it there. Lack of knowledge. Ignorance. Many have died by it. Many churches who are in ignorance today, their members are dying. Where are they going to? Heaven or hell? You died under wrong premises. You died under deceit. Were you in Christ in his holiness? These people that you block them from taking drugs, are they all righteous? Are they children of God? The Bible says all men have no faith. Now you block them and to comply to you so that they too can have positions in the church. They have kept themselves in their sickness. And they die in it. And yet, you see, they die and go to hell. And you have also multiplied hypocrites. Because there are those who cannot, and they privately go and take it and clean their mouth like Gehazi. And they say, Gehazi, where did you go to? I didn't go anywhere. I didn't go anywhere. But it's a sinner before you. You made him a sinner. Because that which is for his good, that which God has made as alternative, you didn't allow him to have access to it. King Saul didn't do well. The children of Israel were running after their enemies. God gave the enemies to them. King Saul pronounced, let no man touch anything until evening. But Jonathan was not aware. He went to take some little honey. His eyes opened. They said, oh, you have disobeyed commandment. Which commandment? And when eventually the time came for the people to now eat, it's 6 o'clock, go and break your fast now, or it is evening. People were eating the animal with blood. Time was no more there for them to roast it. They were too hungry. Because you brought out laws that have no divine backing. You caused the children of God to sin. That's why this knowledge has to come to you. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
Everybody say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Number three, to keep pride and shame from brethren in relation to medicine and medical treatment. Keep pride and shame from brethren in relation to medicine and medical treatment. Now, you are ashamed to take drugs before your brethren. You are ashamed even to go to the pharmacies. You are ashamed to be in the hospital because you feel so great. What if they ask me, bro, you came here? What is happening? No, I just came to see somebody. This is pride. That is a house of mercy. That is a house where your God operates. Are you proud to be there? Are you greater than that house where Jesus is? Because that is where he demonstrates mercy. Oh, shame. And you are suffering from your sickness. You are dying. You need help. There's a way it could have been treated, and that situation, that your family body could have been gone. If they know, which people know? Are they higher than scriptures? Are they higher than God? Again, number four, to rebuke the accusers of brethren for using medicine, traditional or conventional. Herbal or conventional. To rebuke them. Because they are affecting the ways of God. They are causing confusion on the path of righteousness. All things are yours. His God doth teach him. His God doth instruct him to discretion. And all things have been given to you to fully enjoy them. So what are you, why are you accusing the people of medicine? Why are you accusing the people of herbal medicine as if to say it is a sin? What makes it sin? The same knowledge of signs that the Lord gave to manufacture this, to cause sound, to spread sound, amplify sound, so that great crowd can hear his words. It's the same he gave to the scientists to produce the aeroplane, so that long journeys of years can be just done in one day. The same knowledge he gave for the science to build various type of houses, to invent the telephone that you cannot easily say hello, 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 sir, answer hello. Praise the Lord. That same God has given also signs, the knowledge of medicine. You say, no, it's a sin. Why are you entering vehicle? Because it is the man he gave knowledge to that made the vehicle. Where do you take aeroplane? Where do you use microphone in your church? It is the man he gave this sense that has made all those things that you're enjoying now. And he gave the man to make medicine, to discover medicine, how to cure people. He said, no, stop your mouth. Otherwise, you're offending. No, you say herbal medicine is not good. What makes it not good? What makes it not good? Don't you use trees to eat food? From the same trees you heal yourself. Then what do you say it is not good? How did it happen? Where did they get the knowledge? His God taught teach him. His God doth teach him and instruct him to discretion. Go and ask him how he's doing it. He will tell you how the history comes. You only tell the people, don't partake in idolatry. Don't shed blood for anything for me. That's demonism. Don't pay in sacrifice. Don't bring chicken and cut it and spread the blood. Don't. That's all you should to tell the people. What did the disciples say? Don't trouble the Gentiles. All you need to tell them is that you should abstain from blood. And sacrifice to idols. The thing, eating things strangled. That's what you should tell them. And leave them how to have their liberty. You get what we're saying? Again, to bring healing to those who have been sick for long, resisting drugs. Those who have been sick. Especially these young converts. When you tell young convert, wow, you don't need drugs. In fact, he will jump and say, yes, I am here. That's a fresh faith. That is a fresh faith. That faith has not been tested. With time, when he knows reality, shame will take over. Shame will take over. For him to go back and do that, he said, no, they have done me with this now. If I have, in fact, just like this man said, I've said God is so wonderful. If I say, give me escorts now, how would they think? The young convert will, now, for shame, will keep himself and never go to hospital for a sickness that will affect him badly tomorrow. And his life is cut short. No more time to work for Jesus. My people perish. So now, with this truth, go for medicine. In every area where it's required, go for operation. There are women who don't want to go and operate their fibroid. Pastor, pray for me. I believe God can do it. Fear is the problem. God provided grace for that man, for the medical science, to know how to remove fibroid from you. Go for it. Let them do it. And then thank God for all things have been freely given you by God. Amen?
Amen.
That is it. Number six. To doctrinally silence those who assert that taking medicine for cure is sinful. Be it conventional or herbal, food supplement or whatever. Except you can prove that the person who takes it, everybody who takes a commission, if you can prove it, then we say evil is in it. There's a debt in the pot. Otherwise, they take it and are safe and continue in the service of God, continue in the work of God. Which evil are you talking about? Which evil?
Number 6.
To doctrinally silence those who assert that taking medicine for cure is sinful. Number 7. To make brethren enjoy all the provisions of God, which he has made for them for their godly life and ministry. You have a ministry, brother. If that sickness continues, how will it be? You just want to leave the sickness to kill you and say, if God will not kill me, let me die? Do you know the cause of those words? To make brethren enjoy all the provisions God has made for them for godly life and ministry. In summary, the God who has given knowledge for all things, for human convenience, safety, joy, and peace, has given knowledge for medicine to be invented for man. Number 2, medicine does good to man, according to Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22. Medicine does good for man. Number 3, there are 2 types of medicines. 1, healing medicines. 2, poisonous medicines. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 13. There is none to plead thy cause, that thou mayest be bound up. Thou hast no healing medicines. There are medicines that are to poison people, to kill people. There are medicines for destruction. Those are of the devil. But there are medicines for healing. That is God's gift. For your safety, for your peace, for your health. Number 4. Some medicines are gotten from herbs or leaves of trees and other natural provisions of God, as seen in the case of Hezekiah. A lump of figs was brought to be laid upon the boil, and after a time it disappeared. The man didn't die again. Look at it in the book of Ezekiel chapter 47. Ezekiel chapter 47. I read Verse 12. And by the river upon the bank thereof, on this side and on that side, shall grow all trees for meat, whose leaf shall not fade, neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed. It shall bring forth new fruit according to his months, because their waters they issued out of the sanctuary. Can we read the last verse? One to go. And the fruit thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof for medicine. Can you see that? God who made trees for food, by giving us the fruit of it, also gives the leaves for medicine. But how do you, which tree can heal this, heal that? His God doth teach him. God will teach. The person he has called to that work, he will teach him. He will instruct him. And then he will now be teaching others. Others will learn. Others receive inspiration. Others learn. The leaves shall be for medicine. Again, that's what the scripture says. In the book of Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 22. Jeremiah chapter 8, verse 22. It says, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then is not the health of the daughter of my people recovered? Can you see that? They are my people. I expected that with the presence of balm and the presence of a physician there, the health of my people should recover. A balm. You get them from trees. You can get them. So God gives knowledge of, he gave creation, made provision for our healing. So you can now see. Number five. Physicians, doctors, use medicines to cure the sick. Can you see in this scripture? Is there no balm there? Medicine. Is there no physician there that has the knowledge of application of medicine? The physicians have the knowledge of the application of medicines. The doctors. That's why the Bible tells us, yes, physicians have the knowledge to use medicines to cure sickness. Amen. The Bible tells us in the book of Matthew chapter 9 verse 12. Matthew chapter 9. Verse 12. We will read it in chorus. One, two, go. Exactly. But when Jesus had that, he said unto them, they that be whole need not a physician, a doctor, a medical doctor, medical practitioner, but they that are sick. The sick people go to medical doctors. They use medicines and know, they learn how to mix it. How do they learn it? The God of heaven has taught them. And those, some learn them also through learning. They learn from others. And in that way, they cure the sick. They cure the sick. Again, physicians have value in the society. Eh? Doctors have value in the society. Look at it in the book of Job, chapter 13, verse 4. Job chapter 13 verse 4. The Bible says, ye are forgers of lies, ye are all physicians of no value. Job was talking to their friends, to his friend. When I saw you, I thought you were physicians of value that can heal my situation. I came to discover that you are physicians of no value. They are physicians that have value. They have value. People look to them. They heal people. They cure people. Society respects them. Physicians have value. That's what the Bible says. Is there no balm in Gilead? Are there no physician? Or is there no physician there? Where is not the health of my daughter? Or the daughters of my people recovered? Because physicians have value in the society. Number 7. Luke was a physician by profession, and he was loved and cherished by the apostle for his profession. Hence, he was called the beloved physician. Apostle called him. It's likely they enjoyed his service. Look at it in the book of Colossians chapter 4, verse 14. Colossians chapter 4, I read verse 14. The Bible says, Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. Can we read that verse 14 together? 1, 2, go. Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. I want you to check this and say, check where the beloved is. Is it on Luke or on the physician? If that sentence had said, beloved Luke, the physician, you might still be doubting whether this physician something, is there anything good inside? Maybe he was doing it before, but he has repented. Are you getting it now? Who is among us with his profession? And I can do service unto the church, the physicians too. And finally, number 8, Jesus and all that heal the sick by faith and in the name of Jesus are physicians in the spiritual sense. Jesus and all that heal the sick by faith in his name are physicians in the spiritual sense. In Luke chapter 4, verse 22. Luke chapter 4, verse 22. The Bible tells us here, saying, and all, verse 22 and 23, and all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? Verse 23, 1, 2, go everybody. And he said unto them, ye will surely say to me this proverb, physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever we have had done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country. Was Jesus healing physically? No. I said, as a healer, he is a physician. So God works both spiritually and physically. They are all his. There's no realm that belongs that he gave to Satan. He gave the physical realm to man, and he comes there and is working with man in the physical to glorify his name. In the spiritual, he's in authority and control. He remains the healer. And in his name, ye shall heal the sick. Ye shall cast out devils. Amen. Let's rise up and go before the Lord.
Praise your name, O Father, for opening the eyes of your children. Not only this, but others that shall hear the word. Thank you. Thank you. Father, let your knowledge be activated in our lives. Let it be profitable to us. Let it be profitable to your children everywhere as they learn it. Wash. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Disseminate this information. Disseminate this information to set the church free. To prolong the life of people in your church, the lives of ministers and their families, the life of church members and their families, even the life of sinners, so they can hear this gospel. Jesus, help us. Drive away the devil far away from us. Drive him away. Drive him away. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Father, answer our prayers. Amen. Let this knowledge of truth come into your church. Amen. Let it flourish in all the world to redeem people from ignorance. Amen. To glorify your name, that as we exploit all other things you have given to us, we will exploit this one too. Amen. For you have given to us freely all things to enjoy. The ignorance that the devil has brought to your church, sending ministers, people to hell through sickness. Father, overcome that ignorance now in Jesus' name. Amen. Let your people see medicine, be it conventional or the herbal, traditional. As long as it's in purity, let them see it as the gift of God. Let them exploit it for their health and their worship of the living God. Thank you, Father. Heal the sick. Amen. Deliver the oppressed. Break yokes from the bodies of people. Amen. From the lives of people. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.